The URIs and the domain names and host names that we use in them, these human readable names, are only useful if we can actually translate them to an IP address. IP addresses are what are used on the internet. So as a packet is being transmitted across the internet, the routers are looking at the IP address. There's no host name, there's no www.google.com or microsoft.com or whatever that's being used during routing. So in order to send and receive data on the internet, I have to have a destination IP address. So all those things you type in your browser bar, those have to be translated. So let's talk about a little bit about how that happens and show you some tools that you can use to sort of visualize or inspect how the process works. So how do I translate a hostname into an IP address? So every time I go to a website, right, regardless of where I'm going, let's go to csu.buffalo.edu, I have to translate csu.buffalo.edu into an IP address for that to happen. Now, your browser does this internally, and it does this using a service called the domain name system. Like every other part of the internet, the domain name system has its own protocols. You can kind of think of DNS servers a little bit like routers. So routers spend all day doing one very specialized task, which is sending packets down one path or another. A packet arrives, which direction should I send it? DNS servers spend their whole day answering questions from clients. So a client will connect to the DNS server and it will say, how do I translate this address? And the DNS server needs to return the IP address that that address translates to. Just like routers, DNS servers have to cooperate across the entire globe to agree on how to translate names. So if I ask 10 different DNS servers how to translate www.amazon.com, I better get the same answer, because otherwise I'm visiting different web pages depending on who I ask. So there's also this level of coordination among all the DNS servers located all over the world that's required for the system to work. So there are some nice command line tools for showing you how these addresses actually get translated. The one I like to use is something called dig. So let's do a dig on www.internetclass.org. Okay. So I run this this command, and here's what it prints out. So the important section right here is I have a question section. So here's the question I asked. I asked, how do I resolve www.internetclass.org? That has to be resolved into an IP address if I'm going to visit this website, communicate with it in any way, or do anything with it online. So that's my question, and the answer comes back. And the answer says, aha, I know what the answer is. The answer is 128.205.43.182. So this is an example of using DNS, and it returns an IPv4 address. There's an additional section here, right? So what this section is, this is the authority section. So what this is indicating is this domain server that I asked is not in charge of this domain. It's not in charge of internet-class.org. I registered that domain name with Google. And so this says, here are the list of authoritative name servers for that domain. This is how I found out about it, right? So if a DNS server doesn't know something, it can forward the question on to other DNS servers and receive answers, and these are the DNS servers that are responsible for this domain. So they're referred to as authoritative. And you can see that these are googledomains.com. That's where I purchased the domain name. So this isn't a big surprise. Now, down here at the bottom, you'll see that in this case, I asked, the server that I asked is 128.205.1.2. That's a UB IP address. So like many other autonomous systems, UB runs its own domain name server. And I can ask this domain name server not only about addresses at UB, but about any address all over the place. And it cooperates with the other DNS servers to return the correct answer. Now, using dig, I can also ask other DNS servers the same question. So Google operates a set of public DNS servers. One is 8.8.8.8, the other is 8.8.4.4. I don't know how they got such memorable IP addresses for this. So let me ask 8.8.8.8 about www.internetclass.org, and you'll see that I get the same answer. 128.205.43.182, that's good. And in this case, the server I asked is 8.8.8.8.8. Now you'll notice one interesting consequence of how the domain name system works is I need an IP address for a domain name server. I can't identify the domain name server by a domain name, because then how do I translate that name, right? So when I query a domain name server, it's usually done by IP address. When I configure a domain name server, it's also frequently done by an IP address for that reason. Okay, so let me show you a different type of record. So both of these cases, what was returned was something known as an A record, and that's an IP address, an IP version 4 or an IP version 6 address. Let's look at a different example. So this is a different domain that I operate. It's called optawifi.org. It's for a project we're working on. And in this case, the answer section looks a little bit different. So let's talk about that. The first thing that comes back here is it says www.optawifi.org in CNAME. And then it gives me, rather than an IP address, it gives me a different domain name. It says CNAME optawifi.org. So what's going on here? So it turns out that I can actually use DNS to point one domain name at another domain name. And when I try to resolve www.optawifi.org, the first thing that the server is going to do is it's going to look it up and it's going to see, oh, okay, well, that's the same as optawifi.org. Then it looks up optawifi.org, and that resolves, in this case, to a IP address with that familiar UB128.205 prefix. So I can also, this is sort of like a pointer. I can have one name that points to another name as long as that name points to something that eventually points to an IP address. So this is another example of how domain names can be set up. So domain names, every time you use anything online that has a host name, whether it's a website or an email address, this has to happen. Because keep in mind, the IP layer uses IP addresses, which are these numbers, has no idea about these human names that we set up for our convenience. But the translation here is really critical, and it happens all the time.